Welcome everybody. On behalf of Hacking Habitat, Impact Festival and Residencies Utrecht to this very special evening. Soon you will hear Evgeny Morozov and I will take 5 minutes of your time to tell a bit more about me and the Hacking Habitat exhibition. My name is Ine Gevers, I'm the Artistic Director of Hacking Habitat. The theme, How to Beat Bureaucracy, is the theme of the fourth and last Life Hack Marathon we organized in 2015 as a pre-program to the Hacking Habitat exhibition, which opens in 2016. Each time, we invite an internationally renowned keynote speaker to show the fish to water, to enlighten us about the world we live in. How to Be Seen was introduced by Saskia Sasse, explaining how predatory systems globally interact to force people into their logics and push them over the edge. These systems, call them assemblages of powerful multinationals, access to high technology, withdrawing governments, so this whole assemblage together, work in manners opposite of what should be. They should be multi-beneficial for people, profit, planet, but they are not. They are parasitic, to say it at the least, and they feed on human energy. More and more people worldwide are being expelled from their land, their resources, their nation. In the next lecture, How to Fight Debt, the second lecture, Thomas Chetlacek explained economy as a myth. According to this fierce economist, economy has become a fetish, with debt as the drug we are all short of. In the third lecture, How to Cross Borders, artist and technologist James Bridal revealed how we can't even trust on our citizen rights since algorithms judge our online behavior differently every day. Our special guest today is internet skeptic Evgeny Morozov. We share him with Impact and Residencies, which of course is not an easy job for the one who's being shared. Cleverly, Morozov chose his own title, giving him the space and agility to safely satisfy all parties, I hope. The title of his keynote is Silicon Valley, the Invisible Trap, which for us is the start of our Life Hack Marathon session tomorrow. I have to tell you a bit about these Life Hack Marathons. These are workshops that we organize with and for the groups of concern running up against the systems hijacking us. Under guidance of artists, designers, and activists, and philosophers like Marjan Slob, Lino Hellings, Martijn Engelbrecht, and Kars Alfrink, we set the conditions to produce life hacks, a short-term but notably sustainable sustainable and networked hacks. With these life hack marathons, we gather human feedback, our munition, to play a substantial role in the exhibition Hacking Habitat, fusing high-tech control and low-life survival. Does this sound to you a bit like science fiction? More like a crossing between zombie apocalypse and life hacking survival? That's exactly what Hacking Habitat is about. Hacking Habitat, an international exhibition on art, technology, and social change, opens on February 2016. It's February 25th, coming year. Hacking Habitat will be taking over the oldest prison in the Netherlands for 3.5 months. Around 85 artists, hackers, designers will be flying in from all corners of the world to present work, prepare interventions, and provide workshops to reflect and act upon the often invisible but structural violence we found ourselves captured in. Was a panopticum once invented to control and discipline prisoners, now we willfully accept mass surveillance and deliver self-tracked data for free. Our smartphone has become the new panopticum. With wit, humor and play, Hacking Habitat affirmatively promotes new forms of civil disobedience within our high-tech, low-life surroundings. It intends to deliver a multifunctional user guide for smart people in smart cities in a not-too-far future. Okay, that was it. We're looking forward to seeing you there, all of you. But now, I will, as it goes with multi-party events, let me please invite to the floor Arjon Dunnewind, Artistic Director of the Impact Festival. Thank you.
Thank you, Ina. Ladies and gentlemen, dear guests, I'd like to wish you all a very warm welcome to the Impact Festival. Tonight's program, together with yesterday's lecture by Daan Rozegaarde, kicks off the Impact Festival 2015. Tomorrow, we will continue at Theater Kikker with 3 days of lectures, films, installations, discussions, and debate. Every year, Impact focuses on exceptional subjects on the axis of art, technology, media, and society. Our festival, as well as the events, productions, and residencies we organize throughout the year, offer inspiring programs that center on creativity and critical reflection. With our program, we want to direct attention to the current and the compelling, or what we think will receive widespread attention in the very near future. Basically, we hope you will go home from the festival with new insights into subjects you didn't know were important to you yet. Last year, we dealt with artificial intelligence and empathy, effective computing, and the emotional aspects of a relationship between mankind and technology. This year, the Impact Festival will, with the future of the past, once again tackle an urgent topic. The Impact Festival 2015 is a study into the manner in which the constantly growing quantity of information is changing our comprehension of the past and the future. How recall and memory will no longer be what they once were, now they are increasingly part of the interplay between man and machine. Coming Friday to Sunday, Theater Kikker will host a wide range program consisting of international speakers, artists, scientists and critics who will present their work and examine the major question the future of the past poses. For instance, the Dutch police force just received a Big Brother award for their use of predictive analytics. Sunday afternoon, you can join us on a debate of debate on predictive policing. The Impact Festival will introduce a colorful range of guests to Utrecht, from the hackers of the Chaos Computer Club to the archivist of the Utrecht Archive, and from a member of archive.org, an organization that saves websites from oblivion, to the founder of the Graffiti Research Lab. Apart from speakers, we also have an intriguing selection of art films and documentaries. For instance, Trapped, a film in which we can see new media artist Corey Archangel digitally excavating the unique historical treasure of Andy Warhol's experiments on the Amiga computer. We will go back to the early 20th century, to the universe of Paul Otlet, a Belgian scientist who devoted virtually his entire life to his Mundaneum that is viewed as the precursor to the internet. We will also return to the hopeful early 1990s, when the internet became available to ordinary citizens. At the festival, early internet art pioneers who used the internet for their art projects will compare the immense freedom of the early years to the internet as we know it now. We hope that after tonight's event, you will find the time to attend one or more of the Impact Festival's program at Theater Kikker. The coupon you were handed at the entrance entitled you to a discount on tickets. I would like also to thank all the funds that supported the Impact Festival this year. The Municipality of Utrecht, the Stimuleringsfonds Creatieve Industrie, the KF Hein Fonds, the Stichting Democratie en Media, and the Ventener van Vlissingen Fonds. The Impact Festival also never would have come about without the contribution of our sponsors and partners, nor without the invaluable efforts of Impact staff and volunteers. I would particularly like to thank Ineke Lindner, Head of Management, Ilga Mignon, with whom I compiled this year's festival program, Imke Ruigrok and Moritz Geremes for their production, Karen van der Wiel and Bas van der Kraats for publicity, and all other staffs and volunteers. Also, I would like to thank Tivoli Vredenburg for hosting us tonight. Would you please be so kind to give all these people a big round of applause? Tonight is also part of Residencies in Utrecht, a program coordinated by Cultuurpromotie Utrecht and supported by the municipality of Utrecht. Residencies in Utrecht connects a wide range of partners from the arts, science, and education in the city. Together, we invite influential thinkers and inspiring artists to come to Utrecht and share their inspiration and knowledge with us all. We are very happy that we are able to bring tonight's speaker, Yevgeny Morozov, to Utrecht, thanks to Residencies in Utrecht support and the joint efforts of Hacking Habitat and the Impact Festival. He is one of the contemporary world's most influential technology critics. Tonight's program and the panel will be moderated by Mirko Tobias Schäfer. There will not be much time to take questions from the audience tonight, but you're all welcome to come to Theatre Kicker tomorrow to join us for the college tour Yevgeny Morozov. Mirko Tobias Schäfer will conduct a public interview with Yevgeny Morozov there, after which there will be plenty of opportunity to ask questions. The college tour Yevgeny Morozov is tomorrow at 1 o'clock in the afternoon at Theatre Kicker. And if you bought a ticket for tonight's event, please present it to the Kicker box office for free admission to the college tour. However, you should note the capacity is limited. After the impact trailer that you will be screened in a few seconds, Mirko Tobias Schäfer will guide you to the rest of the program. I hope you will enjoy tonight's event.
Good evening. Also, a warm welcome from my side. I'll have the honor of chairing this panel tonight. Tonight's program consists of a keynote lecture by Yevgeny Morozov and a panel discussion. We will be joined by a political activist, Ariane Elfasset, and an entrepreneur, Jons Janssens. My name is Mirko Tobias Schäfer. I'm a co-founder of the Utrecht Data School and an assistant professor at the Utrecht University. And I'll introduce our guest for tonight. Hailing from Belarus, Yevgeny Morozov studied at the American University in Bulgaria. He was a visiting scholar at Stanford University and developed a critical voice on technology. Morozov is not only known for his two best-selling books, The Net Delusion and To Solve Everything, Click Here, but also for his fierce writing style, his witty, critical, and quite damning reviews of publications expressing a techno-optimistic view. While Western media celebrated web platforms and applications as means for democracy and political change, Morozov raised the issue of digital dictatorship. His first book, The Net Delusion, The Dark Side of Internet Freedom, published in 2011, was one of the few publications at the time that convincingly described how those celebrated technologies were used for repression, surveillance, and the manipulation of public opinion. The revelations of Edward Snowden in 2013 merely confirmed that mass surveillance and repression is not limited to authoritarian regimes, but a standing practice even in the countries that praise themselves for their civic rights and their democracy. With this critical voice, Yevgeny Morozov is present in every decent paper and medium that strives for an informed political debate. From The Guardian over Le Monde Diplomatique, the German Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung, or our own national quality paper, The Correspondent. He's present and an indefatigable advocate for a society-wide debate on technology. In line with his criticism of what he calls technological solutionism, he focuses on the impact of big data practices on public administration and civil society. I quote Morozov here. As the welfare state is crumbling, these technology companies are more than happy to provide the public with free services in exchange for our data. Initially, those services were limited to communication and search only, but today, they increasingly include services that promise better healthcare, better education, better transportation, better data analysis, and even better and free connectivity for all. But what are the economic, political, and social consequences of accepting this free bargain? He will be speaking quite in line with the festival topic about the future of our past, about the future of the welfare state. Is Silicon Valley the new welfare state? Please welcome with me our keynote speaker, Yevgeny Marozov.
Thank you very much, Mirko, for this introduction, and thank you to Hacking Habitat and Impact Festival for bringing me to Utrecht. I should say at the outset that at most events where I speak, I am introduced as an internet critic, and tonight's was not, and a skeptic, which is worse, and tonight's was not an exception, and I always try to challenge that view from the very outset because it, I think, shapes the rest of the perception. I don't think that in any meaningful way I am an internet skeptic. If by the internet you mean a collection of technologies like sensors, big data, algorithms, and so on, what I am critical of and what I am a skeptic of is the ability of corporations, most of them American ones, to deliver on the promises that they make about these technologies that they come to own and run in accordance with their business models. So in no way would I like to send the message that all of those technologies are useless, pointless, or irrelevant. What I would like to emphasize, and that will be probably at the heart of my presentation tonight, is that the current way in which they're owned, run, and administered by a handful of giant American monopolies does not really reflect the interests of the public, and certainly so the public in Europe. So this is just a footnote to my biography. Now, to kick it off, what I was invited here, and you know, we had to bring together the themes of these two festivals, one of which is about how to beat bureaucracy, and the other one is about the future of the past. I immediately thought of the welfare state in Silicon Valley, in part because, in some sense, when you think about bureaucracy, probably the first thing comes to mind is precisely the welfare state. And second, I think more and more people are increasingly convinced that it's very hard to see what kind of future the welfare state might have, as it's either running out of money or it's being displaced by much leaner, faster, more effective, and of course digital alternatives, most of them provided by Silicon Valley and other technology firms. And this is why I think thinking about the future of the welfare state through the perspective of Silicon Valley is a good entry into both of the themes of the two events. That said, let me give you my scissors from the very beginning in case you're going to lose me as I speak, and I'm surprised that I'm still speaking very slow. Usually it's much faster, so if it gets too fast, you have to wave at me. So the scissors of my talk tonight is that technology, and internet technology, and by that, of course, I mean technology that currently comes out of Silicon Valley, is serving as some kind of a magic wand, as some kind of a hidden reservoir, as some kind of a hidden, underused, and underexploited resource that allows our political system, our welfare state in Europe, it is mostly the welfare state, to keep on going and pretend that things are actually not just working well, things are actually getting better. I would like to challenge that view. Things are not working well, and things are not getting better. And the solutions that Silicon Valley offers to patch up a lot of the holes and cracks that have appeared in the architecture of our welfare state, those patches are only short term. They aren't going to resolve the underlying crisis. And I would argue that under the hype of innovation, disruption, entrepreneurship, what is being pushed on citizens who do not necessarily understand the long-term implications of the shifts is a vision that has very little to do with the welfare state and even less to do with a much more communal and public vision for the provision of services like health, education, transportation, and you name it. So what do I mean by any of those things? Well, let's start with the welfare state before we get to the role that Silicon Valley currently plays. I'm not going to give you a lecture on the origins and the current state of the welfare state in Europe, in part because it varies so much from country to country and from region to region, but let me just state out the basics. I think most people in this room would agree that the welfare state is not necessarily what is being painted as when you listen to American laissez-faire kind of neoliberal commentators. It was not a communist plot by any means to take over the public welfare and create some kind of a communist utopia. If anything, welfare state in Europe was the opposite. It was a way not to have a communist utopia arrive, and that was a compromise that various social democratic governments in Europe have struck with the market. And we can talk about Bismarck, we can talk about the Beveridge Report in Britain in the 1930s, which led to the introduction of National Health Service. But the basic reality remains the same. The welfare state in Europe has always been some kind of a compromise between the market, which would be allowed to function in one way or another and spread its logic into as many domains as possible, and the institutions that would be erected to correct some of the more insidious effects of the market, like unemployment, like some of the traditional problems that occur in the lives of workers, poor health, insurance, you name it, education, and so forth. But the idea was never to provide a free-for-all utopia. The idea was always to provide just enough so that workers can actually recover and come back to the employment and develop personally, professionally, academically, and so forth. Of course, as we all know, for various reasons, which I think are deeply political, that model has run into problems. Right? And the problems that it has run into are both fiscal and strategic and political in character. On the one hand, of course, we know what kind of problems we have been having in Europe, problems like aging, problems like lack of babies being born, and so forth. And that, of course, has put a rather restricting demand on the welfare. But of course, there have been other things that were happening. There was less and less money to be spent on public services because that money was going elsewhere. A lot of it, and we have discovered in the last 7 years or so, has gone to bail out the banks. Some of that money went elsewhere. There has been a huge wave of privatizations that have happened, partly as a way to patch up these problematic areas of the welfare state. Let's just put it this way, the welfare state seems to be in a rather bad shape. And of course, that wasn't necessarily unexpected. If you listen to a lot of people 30 years ago who were warning about the ultimate consequences of the kind of rhetoric that was coming out of Britain and the United States with the rise of Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan, they were warning that the privatization of everything will eventually give us inferior services, it will make us pay more for insurance, it will make us feel much more responsible for our own affairs, and more than that, it will result in basically citizens having to take on the burden of funding more and more services out of their own pocket, not through taxes, as has been the case with the welfare state, but out of their own pockets through earnings, income, and so forth. Right? So the drastic vision that was painted 30 years ago or so was that the changes that were being introduced to the welfare state would result in a world where basically we will have to pay for everything. We'll have to pay for education, we'll have to pay for health, we'll have to pay for transportation, all of that will be happening. And partly I'm sure you would agree, even in Holland, partly this is what has happened. There are more and more expectations that we'll be paying for those things out of our own pocket, and there will be all sorts of new correlational schemes built into the system that will actually reflect our own contribution to the problem, so to say. So instead of charging everybody the same amount for the insurance, for the health, for transportation, people will be charged a much more personalized, precise fee for what it is that they owe to the system based on some kind of distribution of risks, rewards, expectations, and so forth. And so that has just been a way to make the state leaner for all the reasons I've described, in part because there was not enough money to pay for everything, and in part because there was just a general feeling that the bureaucracy and the state is just too fat and it needs to be shrunk down because it's just too generous and it makes people lazy. Anyhow, that was the logic that the neoliberal critics of the welfare state have put forward. I would argue that even though much of that vision has come to fruition, much of it has not. And it has not, and probably will not, for a simple reason. Suddenly, we have a new actor who was not necessarily anticipated on the scene 20 or 30 years ago. And that actor is precisely Silicon Valley, which offers a very interesting tick, so to say, a very interesting innovation on the idea of welfare. And it's welfare that is provided by companies, and it's something that performs a very similar function to the traditional functions of the welfare state, but it does it in a very interesting manner that I think has not really been fully analyzed. And very few people actually see Silicon Valley through that perspective. And whenever I try to raise those issues in the United States, people look at me as if I was from Mars, because the last thing that they think about when they think about Silicon Valley is the welfare state, because they think about Google and Facebook, and immediately they think about Ayn Rand and libertarianism and all sorts of Californian ideology, and they think that the last thing that probably these guys want to do is to provide free health, education, and everything for the rest of the world. I actually think that they're mistaken. And they're mistaken for the sole reason that if you look at some of the services that this company is already providing, they actually are a sort of a welfare state, at least when it comes to information. So if you were to think of what would an information welfare state look like 60 years ago, 70 years ago, when you know in Britain they were passing the Beveridge Report in the 30s, they were thinking about what would healthcare look like under the welfare system. So imagine if we had to think about information. Also, well, if we were to think about information and welfare, I would argue that we would probably, with the limitations in our thinking already imposed by the kind of welfareist model, which I remind you was never meant to be communist to begin with, we would arrive at something like Google probably running much of our communication infrastructure and doing it in a way that is actually free for all, just like it is now. And what I mean here is that if you actually look at who currently pays for enabling access to information, knowledge, and data for most people in probably most countries or developed countries in the world, you'll see that it's not being paid directly by me, it's not being paid directly by you, the citizen, it's not being paid by the government directly, it's being paid by this company called Google, which is providing us with a lot of free services. And the services range from search, as I have mentioned, they range to Google Scholar, which a lot of academics use. They range to email, which a lot of us are using. And they might stretch to many other services, smart thermostats, smart cars, smart everything, which is sort of the vision of Google. And as you can notice, what unites many of the services and platforms is that they are being provided for free. And by free, I mean that nobody is being charged for those services. With a few exceptions, when you want a larger mailbox, of course, Google will accept money from you. But by and large, the majority of people who use those services do not actually pay anything for them while they're being served the services. And of course, it's not rocket science. All of you know that there is a hidden part to this transaction. And the hidden part is that Google simply has found a way to make money in the background with our use of those services. Right, so as we are doing a search on Google, there is an advertising auction system running in the background of the service, which immediately matches our intention as expressed by the search item we are searching for, and some kind of a customer who wanted to purchase advertising from Google. That match is made. There might be an auction happening in the background who would like to bid the highest. In the meantime, transaction is made. Some money has been earned. We got the free service. Google got a cut. Somebody got the advertising they wanted, everybody is happy. And I think that a lot of people, at least if you look at the users of the services, have been rather uncritical in their acceptance of this model. Because most of us don't really see the damage in using those platforms, despite the revelations from Snowden, despite the revelations that we've seen in the last few years, there doesn't seem to be much of a backlash against that. And it's very easy to understand why this is happening, and it's simply that for most people who want to have a convenient service to, and access to information, there just is not any other alternative. And most people and also know that there are no governments, with a very few exceptions, and certainly not in Western Europe, who are trying to build those alternatives, because our governments have become more or less content with a world where information is being collected, indexed, and provided not by libraries, which was actually some kind of a welfare state when it comes to information before Google, but is provided by a handful of corporations from California. And I can assure you that very few governments are thinking ahead when it comes to designing alternative systems for the provision of those telecommunication services. If you were to think, for example, how would those governments, if only they could, redesign their postal system if they had to redesign it now? I mean, clearly, few governments are thinking about it. Most of them are thinking about winding down those postal services because people are using email. But if you think about applying the Google model to post office, you can clearly see how it would work. Google's offer here would be very simple. It would be to say, well, why charge people for stamps? If we can build a system where we would open every letter at the post office, look inside, insert an ad, and forward it at our own expense. I mean, that's the model in which Google operates, and that's the model by which you get free email and you get free search. And the argument that I would like to push tonight is that this is more or less the model according to which the rest of society will function if these companies have their way in terms of integrating more and more data streams into their activities. And I would also argue that as we leave the world of information research, and if we leave the world of just using a search engine or writing an email, and as we enter the world of education, transportation, health, and other services, which now clearly have an information dimension, it's very hard for us to think that transportation today doesn't have an information dimension, or health doesn't have an information dimension. All of them have an information dimension. And as all of the services enter this new age of informationalization, to me it seems quite clear that Silicon Valley, represented by Google, Facebook, a handful of other companies, would like to be present in all of them. And that would not necessarily happen and just through your interaction with particular platforms and gadgets as they run. It might happen in the invisible background as these companies strike deals with cities to develop smart city agenda, as they strike companies with entire governments, as they strike, in other way, deals, in other words, deals with administrative and state players, who for the same reason that they accepted the introduction of email and search run by private corporations will be also happy to accept the introduction of other services run by Google, Facebook, and others in a way that will be cheaper, leaner, and more efficient. So I don't think that most governments at this point in Europe anyway, and I would argue that would be the case also in many parts of Latin America and Southeast Asia and Africa for sure, I don't think that governments actually are actively interested in opposing the Silicon Valley model. They are more than happy to embrace it because they themselves do not seem capable anymore to offer the kind of welfare that is expected of them. In much of the developing world, this will not actually be welfare because they never provided it to begin with, so it will be state building from scratch, and there these companies will be replacing the likes of World Bank, the UN, and IMF, and they will be building infrastructure of the country from scratch. And I would argue that that resistance from governments is nowhere to be seen, and governments actually are more than happy to make alliances with these companies. And you can already see it in Europe, almost in every country that you look at. Now, let me unpack this a bit more. Why should we worry about Silicon Valley or Google or Facebook running your health in a way that is much more profound than Google and Facebook running your search engine? And I don't want to denigrate the importance of those companies running search engines. I think it's a very important issue, but I think we have to understand that there are more things at play when you start thinking about things like health. The model according to which Silicon Valley solves health And here I have to generalize and talk about Silicon Valley the way some people talk about Wall Street, but such are the costs of trying to articulate a theory. So I'm more than aware that there are lots of apps that try to articulate a different logic. My conviction is that they are very small and tiny and represent a minority. That's why I feel confident in generalizing and saying that Silicon Valley does this, because I'm quite confident that this is actually what's happening if you look at the scale. So what does Silicon Valley do in health? Well, the model is very simple. They try to capture as many measurements of our own individual symptoms and indicators of our personal health as they can. And you know very well what those indicators are. Those are our heart rate, pulse, walking, how much we exercise, what we eat, how much we sleep, how well we sleep, and so on. All of the data is increasingly easy to collect, aggregate, and analyze for the sole reason that it's also being captured by a lot of sensors that are already built into our devices or that we carry in our pockets, or they're built into various smart environments with which we interact on a daily basis. All of the data is being collected, aggregated, and analyzed mostly with the sole purpose of actually trying to inform us as to what it is that we can do to avoid a potential health problem hitting us in the future, right? I mean, that's all they do. They work in a very preemptive diagnostic manner by analyzing essentially what we do and what we don't do, and they seek to generate an intervention. Some behavioral economists might call it a nudge, which seeks to steer our behavior in a somewhat different direction. And those nudges can be of very different kinds. I mean, they're mostly generated through notifications you get on your phones, tablets, and other devices. And they do not just apply in health, as you well know, they also apply in energy, they apply in many other domains where there is some basic collection of information, and then an effort to steer and change our behavior in a somewhat different direction. So, what is not to like about nudging behavioral economics and the use of these notifications? Well, I would argue that there is one fundamental problem with those systems, and it has to do with their politics, which is not actually presented to the public. I would argue that the reason why behavioral economics has become so popular and why behavioral economics has become so tightly embedded with manufacturers of various technological gadgets and various companies that are collecting data is in part because at this point, this is the only way that our governments can actually affect some change in domains like health, education, energy, climate change, and so forth, without undertaking any systematic, ambitious efforts to resolve the actual root causes of those problems. So since we cannot resolve the root causes of those problems, and by the way, those root causes, we can easily identify and pinpoint. Again, depending on what view of causality you take, I think we will probably be able to point our finger, for example, on issues like health and obesity, to the role of big food companies in feeding a lot of unhealthy food to kids. We can also point the finger to urban planners who design, and I'm talking about America, for example, who design cities in a way that does not make it easy for people to actually walk, so they have to take a car. We can point the finger to lots of other historical, economic, and political forces that have produced a problem like obesity. Obesity is not just an individual problem. Obesity, I would presume, is a problem that is collective, social, and historical in nature. And the same would apply to climate change, the same would apply to a lot of other problems that currently can be solved at a new level, which wasn't available before, or it was available in a very ineffective manner. Of course, you could previously also appeal to citizens in a way that was extremely unpersonalized. You would be doing public advertising campaigns, telling people not to smoke, or telling people to move more, telling people to exercise, while the hope was, and I'm not saying that it was always effective, but there was always some hope that our political process would somehow enable us to also go against other possible people and actors and institutions responsible for causing problems in question. And those processes might involve regulating the lobbyists, maybe tying their hands, regulating the companies, trying to do something to diagnose the problem at a level where there are other factors and forces involved and not just the individual. What has happened with this turn towards nudging behavioral economics, which is all relying on a lot of personalized data that's being collected about individuals, is that we have conveniently forgotten that our problems are not just caused by individual misbehavior and people being irrational or people just being irresponsible. And in that sense, the rhetoric that now comes out of Silicon Valley pitching us all those apps matches the logic of neoliberalism, which I would argue is all about responsabilization. It's all about making people responsible, or at least feeling responsible, that every single problem in their life stems from their own sense of irresponsibility. So there is an effort to make us more rational, to make us more moral, to make us do things which we would not otherwise do, and that in itself is presented as a way to fight the problem. And unfortunately, that's where we are. We are not gathering data with those gadgets and technologies that we are carrying in our pockets about the behavior of lobbyists and the way in which they hijack certain policies at the national European level. That's not the kind of data you can easily produce with a self-tracking device in your pocket. We're not generating a lot of other data. And I can argue, of course, I can agree, and we'll probably hear a lot of these arguments and responses to my talk, that, of course, there is the open data movement, there are efforts to actually open up a lot of government data and so forth. I would argue that actually the data that matters about institutional corruption, about where the money goes, is not that hard to find. I can point you to a lot of data about where the money that the European Commission allocates on technology projects, it's all available, and we know where it goes. It goes to big telecoms. That's not a secret. It's there. We just lack the political process to actually go and redirect that money and channel it to processes which would actually benefit the citizens rather than corporations. That's a failure of the political project in Europe, and we pretend not to notice it. And instead, we are focusing on things that are relatively trivial, sorry for my harsh words of critique, while pursuing this vision of highly decentralized, innovative, disruptive technologies that will help us resolve all those problems simply by more or less letting ourselves be surveyed even further. But I think there are other consequences here, especially if you look away from Western Europe and start analyzing what's happening in the developing world, something that I already mentioned, with these companies taking on a role of development institutions. If you look at what Facebook has been doing in the developing world with its internet.org project, I think you'll clearly understand what kind of public and political role Facebook has in store for itself and for those regions. So for those of you who don't know, internet.org is something of a fake nonprofit initiative that was set up by Facebook in cooperation with a lot of mobile operators, which basically enters big chunks of the developing world, countries like India, a lot of countries in Africa, a lot of countries in Latin America, and they promise them free internet access, which again is part of the same kind of welfare state that we would have actually loved. I mean, who would expect that Mark Zuckerberg would be going around offering free goods to people? Right, and here he is going and meeting with lots of presidents, including presidents of countries that you cannot yet classify as fully neoliberal, like Brazil, pitching them a service which does, in some very limited sense, promote the vision of digital inclusion, which makes a lot of people in those governments very excited because, hey, why not have digital inclusion promoted by Facebook if that will free up the government, which is not really capable of promoting digital inclusion on its own anyway? Right, so they're more than happy to make alliances with those companies. So what does internet.org do? Well, it does offer you free access, but that free access extends only to Facebook and a handful of other services and apps. Everything else you have to pay for by traffic, and this is the arrangement. And Facebook's argument is that, well, it's better to have Facebook on your phone than to have nothing. Right? And if you have abandoned any kind of idea and belief that collectively people can actually promote things like digital inclusion, yes, you'll probably agree. If you imagine yourself part of a neoliberal society where the only vehicle of social and political change is the market, then of course you would naturally say that, well, I mean, so far that's the best that the market has offered me, so I might as well go for Facebook. Right? I don't think, however, that that's the only thing that we can do when it comes to digital inclusion. Right? This is why the efforts by companies like Facebook to redefine even what digital inclusion means, to me, smack very much of the efforts that some loan sharks and very bad banks were undertaking to redefine what financial inclusion means. Right? The fact that somebody gives you a very big loan and then wants to have it back at extraordinary rates might result, of course, in some very bizarre promotion of financial inclusion, but I think it's a financial inclusion that's not of the kind that we would necessarily want to promote in society. Right? And I would argue that what we are seeing with Facebook is not that far from the very same situation. So the world that we currently have also means that if you want to reach a lot of those people in Africa, Brazil, Latin America, Southeast Asia, and so forth, and if you want to put, say, university lectures online and make them accessible to students in the developing world, you'll be far better off channeling all that content through Facebook. Because as long as people access that content on Facebook, they wouldn't have to pay for it. Which means that suddenly we have this new layer, this new intermediary, that has been erected in place of institutions like universities and so forth, which actually now suddenly collects all the data about the process like learning that was previously unmediated by anybody except universities and the students. Suddenly, if you want to study, you have to be on Facebook. That's just the economic incentive that has been created, and I believe in economic incentives even though I'm not a neoliberal economist. Right? And unfortunately, Facebook will be the one running that infrastructure, I would argue, for a very long time. And a lot of governments would be more than happy to have Facebook do that. But again, that highlights the way in which Facebook's quest for data, which they know how to convert into cash eventually, helps them actually step in and build some of the resources that we would traditionally classify as the welfare state. And I would argue that if you think about companies like Google, and their future, and their present, Europe is nowhere close to actually developing any kind of alternative or even developing some kind of a vision for how we can function outside of this growing dependence on them. And there is this belief in Europe, which I find very amazing every time I come here, and I come here almost every week, that somehow companies like Google can be disrupted if only we fund enough entrepreneurs working in a garage who, you know, will be the European version to Steve Jobs and will come up with a better algorithm and then turn their company into an Airbus to Google's Boeing, right? I'm afraid this is not going to happen because, again, we fundamentally misunderstand that this new welfare state that's being built by Google, Facebook, and others is ultimately built on data, right? This is what drives it. It is data, right? And it's data that allows them to offer all those services because they have found a way, and I'm not saying that this will last forever. Perhaps in a good world, the advertising markets will collapse overnight and there will be no value in this data. I mean, there's also a possibility and we can hope and pray in the sort of best Walter Benjaminian sense that perhaps there will be this religious experience happening. Short of that happening, data remains the asset that makes those companies almost impossible to disrupt. And I actually think that if Google manages to penetrate many of those domains, and you know, I haven't even mentioned half of them. I mean, if you really pay close attention to Google, you'll see that they're building new laboratories and apps, like mushrooms they're growing inside the company. They're building a special lab for solving city problems. They're trying to fight and solve aging, whatever that means. They're trying to build smart lenses to help people with diabetes. They're trying to enter quite a lot of areas that have nothing to do with search, but have quite a lot to do with data, right? And why is thinking about data so important these days? I would argue that ultimately, we should not even imagine that in 5 years' time, Google will still be a search company. I think this is a paradigm that's completely outdated. We should start thinking of Google as a data company and perhaps as some kind of a welfare consultancy company. They will not be offering search in the traditional sense, and you already know it if you've been using any of their flagship products like Google Now. If you look at Google Now is actually a product that is cannibalistic on Google's own core product, which is search. For those of you who don't know, Google Now is a service that basically integrates not just every single Google service that you might be using, like Google Maps, Google Mail, YouTube, Google Scholar, and so forth, but also integrate some third-party services like Spotify, Airbnb, Uber, and others, which basically means that anything that happens in your life, your travel, your visits to museums, you're walking in the city, you're going to restaurants, everything is being analyzed in real time. All the email that comes to you that mentions a particular event, you know, you might have a meeting at 7 o'clock, that meeting will be automatically added to your calendar. All of that is a way to take hassle out of your everyday living, which also means that you want to take the hassle of search out of your everyday living, which means that you will be conducting searches for people before they even want to search. Right? And this is what Google means by autonomous search, which is basically trying to feed you and serve you enough data in real time, anticipating your needs based on your location, previous experiences, and so forth. Right? Which to me means that all this talk about algorithms as a way to disrupt Google is misleading, because clearly here the predictive power does not lie in the algorithm, it lies in the data that Google has accumulated and keeps on its servers. And it's also the data, by the way, about how many steps do you take this month as opposed to last month. I mean, it's one of the cards in Google Now, which if you enable certain settings in your phone, will pop up and tell you that, well, this month you have not been walking enough. Right? Which would probably be a card that your insurance company would like to see one day. Right? I mean, there is quite a lot of data that's of very sensitive and interesting nature that's being collected, and you can clearly see how one's tied to a very different service like insurance or like health will have a very different value from the kind of data that we are generating in our inboxes now when we think about advertising. But it also means that I don't think that there is a way to disrupt any of these companies without actually addressing the question of data and the way in which data in itself can create alternatives to the welfare state. Because to be honest, I have no faith left in the welfare state as it exists today. In part because to begin with, it wasn't really such a great idea, because another alternative to the welfare state was the basic income, right? Where the government will give you a set of money, and they would not, well, a set of cash, and they will not necessarily be tracking everything you do, which is kind of the model according to which the welfare state operates. In this sense, you know, there is not that much difference between the surveillance that is done by welfare agencies that would like to know how you're spending their money and the NSA. If you were a libertarian, or if you were just concerned with surveillance, you'd be surveyed about the welfare state as well. Right? Which means that there are many other alternatives which I think should be explored, and we should not stick to the defending the model, which might not necessarily be that useful. But what I'd like to say is that we have to address the question of data and how it will actually enable alternative sources of welfare that will accrue to communities, cities, nations, regions, however far you would like to go. But it will not embrace this extremely individualistic neoliberal logic of Silicon Valley, according to which you are the one responsible for all of your own problems, so you should also be the one responsible for solving them. This is the logic, and I think you have to understand that at a certain point in history, Silicon Valley gave neoliberalism a very useful term and a very useful label, and that label was hacking. I'm sorry to say that we have it in the name of one of our events, but the hacker is the kind of typical, in the politicized version as we currently use the term now, it is the politicized version of the kind of perfect neoliberal subject who is capable of solving all of their problems on their own with ingenuity, creativity, and resourcefulness and resilience. This is what hackers do. They learn how to code, and then they are set. Whatever problem comes their way, they magically solve it. There is no need to work with communities. There is no need to design institutional solutions. There is no need to do anything. You can just be on your own, and then you'll be resilient and safe. I'm not saying that that covers everybody, and certainly there are lots of hackers who are very political and occupy the extreme opposite end of the political spectrum, but I think we have to understand that this constant incitement and this constant insistence that we become responsible for our own stuff, for our own affairs, for our own health, for our own problems, is partly enabled by this rhetoric of empowerment through technology that emanates from Silicon Valley. So if we want to think about alternatives to solving problems on a different logic that will be more social, more communal, more collaborative, you know, there are also lots of community-related terms that have been appropriated by the neoliberal toolkit, and I would not want to deny that. But still, I think that there is some utility in us thinking about how we can solve problems differently that just not does default to the level of the individual. And this is where I think data comes into play, and we have to design a way that will be and will go beyond the two options that we currently face from Silicon Valley. So option number one, which is offered to us by the likes of Google and Facebook, is the following. It basically states that they have the computing resources that are not available anywhere, probably not in any nation state, maybe except the USA with the power of National Security Agency. So they have also, through political process, it was not just a coincidence that these companies managed to enter so many markets, so many domains, install sensors everywhere, get data from everywhere. I mean, Google spends more money on lobbying now in the US, I think, than Goldman Sachs, right? It should tell you that things do not just happen spontaneously, right? This sort of Hayekian idea of spontaneous order does not really apply when you have lobbying budgets of Google size. Right, so there are very systematic efforts involved in making it as powerful and as widespread as it is. But that aside, the argument that these companies right now are making is that given the scale of the infrastructure and given the scale of the data collection, the best we can do is to basically let them collect all the data, let them analyze it, and let them provide some kind of welfare to us that will make our life easier. And in this case, something like Google Now is a perfect example of that logic in action, because Google Now, what does it do to you as a user? Well, it gives you one resource that in some sense, this compromise between the market and the state and the workers was supposed to offer in the past, and this is free time. Google Now just does just that. It's a way to generate free time out of thin air. They analyze all of your activities, they survey them, they engage in sophisticated analysis of where you'll be going, where you'll be traveling, where you might need to go, and they basically generate free time for you, obviating you from engaging in some bureaucratic hassle. You know, and it's not insignificant, and I can understand why a lot of people who are overworked or have a lot of parenting duties or working duties and whatnot would actually like to be surveyed even more, because the more they are surveyed, the more free time they generate. It's a very simple system. That, of course, would not be possible in a world where our technological environment is either extremely decentralized, so that you cannot analyze data coming from so many resources at such a huge scale, or data is proprietary, or it's built in a way that is in one way or another encrypted, so these companies cannot look into it. So Google's argument is basically, you know, Facebook and others, but I'll stick to Google. Google's argument is that give us your data, let us expand, and you'll get the benefits that you cannot imagine, right? And you can only think about what will happen if they start analyzing how you sleep, what you eat, and so forth, with smart lenses, smart cars, smart thermostats. They'll also save you visits to the doctor. They'll inform you about the possibility of a heart attack years in advance. We just should let them survey us. And that's a model that I think a lot of people will find appealing these days, particularly as the welfare state itself, which was supposed to offer a different kind of model, we could actually afford to get sick and then go see a doctor rather than spend your entire life worrying that you might get sick and thus adjusting your behavior accordingly. That model is crumbling and it's no longer available for reasons that we can explore and that I've partly alluded to. So a lot of people will find that vision very appealing. The other vision is the more entrepreneurial one, and it's also not surprisingly offered to us by Silicon Valley. And that other vision states something that's different and that not involve monopolies of the Google size. And what this other option offers is to basically make us into curators and entrepreneurs of our own data. That, and the idea is that we can basically collect all of the data that we generate, and we should collect it on our own. We should claim that this is our own private property, and then we should deposit it in some kind of a data bank that will be run by these other companies and startups that will yield us an interest on that rate, on that data, that will rent us some kind of a money, a return from basically making that data useful to advertisers, drug companies, or anybody else who would like to have access to it. Right? And it's a very kind of interesting populist project that tries to convince people that the data that we generate is our own asset, it's a commodity, there is value attached to it, we should claim it as our own, and we should fight for it, and we should make money from it. Right? Of course, if you start applying this logic to your daily life, a lot of weird things start appearing on your radar, because you suddenly realize that every social interaction that you have can be monetized. Every single thought that you have can be monetized. Every single act that you do can be monetized as long as you put enough sensors and you run enough auctions in the background in your apps and in your smart devices. So you go to your shower and sing your daily song every morning and you realize that, hey, maybe the manufacturer of my shampoo would like to buy the knowledge which song I'm singing. Well, maybe yes. If your phone has an app that can sell that song in the background the way Google sells apps when you're doing a search, yes, you'll earn 5 cents. Great. You know, if you start applying that logic to the rest of your life, you will see that, yes, perhaps there are a lot of people who eventually will be interested in buying that data. Right now, this is not necessarily the case. You know, I went and visited one of those data startups in New York a few weeks ago, and what I discovered is that the market for this data is actually relatively small now, so what venture capitalists are doing is that they're putting their own money to convince people that this data is valuable. So they're the ones paying people to buy their data. Right? So it's the same venture capitalists who are creating the startups, also the ones who are then paying people to buy that data, pretending that there are all the shampoo manufacturers who would like to buy it. Right? For this whole reason that they want to create this consumer awareness that data has a value and we should think about it as entrepreneurs. I would argue that both of those options present to us a very false and binary choice. And that if we were really serious about building services, welfare services, some kind of welfare provision, that would not default to the neoliberal logic. And for me, both of those solutions default to the neoliberal logic. One, because it basically leaves everything in the hands of a giant American monopolist, with lots of implications, including geopolitical ones, which I'll be more than happy to explore in the Q&A. So that option, not particularly good. And the other option for me is not particularly good either, because it leads to the ultimate financialization of everyday life, whereby the logic of the market becomes the yardstick by which we judge and evaluate our own being in the world, which, if you think about it, was the initial goal of most neoliberals. And neoliberal economists, if you go to Hayek and you read them, you understand that this is what they wanted. They wanted us to basically put the market at the center of every single social political interaction that we have. So I don't like that logic either. So the only solution that remains, and I'm nearing the end of my talk, so it will not be a very sophisticated vision, but maybe we can sharpen it a little bit during Q&A, is that we have to find a way through which those reservoirs of non-neoliberal political power that still exist in Europe, and I know that this is a mouthful, and I would say that the only reservoirs that I have in mind right now are cities, some cities, and some communities and regions within cities that actually actively oppose the logic of privatization, that actively oppose putting markets in charge of everything. We have seen quite a few efforts at remunicipalization happening in Germany, in Italy, elsewhere. We have seen quite radical mayors elected in Barcelona and Madrid who now are faced with the challenge of reinventing a smart city that would exist outside of the hands of HP, Cisco, maybe Philips, Google, and a few others. And they're not having necessarily a very successful run, but they are the actors that currently at least can think in a way that does not default to the market being the answer to everything. And at this point, for me, Silicon Valley is a political project rather than anything else, because if you really accept its offer, you will end up with the market becoming the main method and vehicle for delivery of everything everywhere. So there is no way not to have a political reading and also geopolitical reading of Silicon Valley. And you'll see it even more if you start reading the ways about free flow of data in TTIP, TISA, and all of the fantastic trade agreements that our governments are signing. It's all there, and you can make those connections. But the point that I would like to conclude on is that we have to articulate a way in which those urban city community-like alternatives and services that would like to offer a public transportation system that would actually be based on real-time analysis of the needs of the people, right? And I can easily imagine that people will be using their phones to communicate where they are. Perhaps they will even be paying with their phones after they use the service, which is one of the main advantages that Uber right now has. But it will not default to the rest of the package that comes with a company like Uber, which is extremely precarious employment for the drivers, extremely unpleasant mechanism of drivers ranking passengers and passengers ranking drivers. Of course, all of it done solely to reduce transaction costs for the company. And it comes with a lot of other nasty practices at the city level, national level, and so forth. We have to be able to offer smart, algorithmic, big data-driven public transportation that will rely on extremely secure, encrypted data flows, but that will not have the rest of the package that comes once it's only a bunch of private companies backed up by Google and Goldman Sachs, which is the case with Uber, are the only ones providing them. So when I see some local initiatives in Europe, in Helsinki, for example, there is an initiative to provide something like a public transportation whereby people can specify where they would like to go on their phone and where they are, and then the system will analyze their real-time demands in the cloud with an algorithm and will actually send a minibus. They will pick up 7 or 8 passengers and will drop them off along the route that has been pre-calculated just for them in real time. And they will pay just 2 or 3 euros and not 20 or 30, and they will not have to engage in any of the ranking business that Uber forces on us, and the drivers will actually get paid. I would like to see more of those initiatives, but I'm afraid that those initiatives will be very hard to enact without us coming up with a very different property regime for data, which perhaps will acknowledge that citizens own that data, but should not necessarily be trading it, just like we have a lot of other goods that we can own, but not necessarily trade. This is not a new thing. And that will have a more economically and politically humane way to run them. But I'll just finish here, but I just also don't want to sound like a utopian here who thinks that the changing the data ownership regime will solve all of our problems. I mean, the problem, of course, is much deeper and has to do with the infrastructure that also generates that data. So we also have to think about many other layers. Who owns the sensors, who owns the networks, who owns the telecoms, all of those questions that have been taken off the table through uncritical embrace of privatization have to be brought back if we really hope to live in a world where Silicon Valley is not our sole provider of public welfare services. Unfortunately, we are nowhere close to doing that, but I'm afraid that without having this holistic vision for how we can reclaim some of that infrastructure back, we will end up with either Google or some startup running our health, education, and transportation. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Yevgeny. Thank you very much for the talk. We will now proceed to a debate which starts with two respondents. I will introduce the first respondent. Arjen Alfacet is director of the Open State Foundation, a non-profit organization promoting digital transparency through open data. He holds an MA in political science and international relations from the Leiden University. He's a former member of parliament in the Netherlands, dealing with digital agenda, foreign affairs, development aid, and European affairs. He worked as a policy advisor at international development agencies such as Oxfam International, as well as human rights organizations in the Middle East. Please, Arjen.
Well, if you thought that we were going to talk about technology, I think we are disappointing you, because it's a talk about and a discussion about politics and about the relation between citizens vis-a-vis governments, consumers vis-a-vis big corporations. And actually, I think it's a debate about the rights and protections people have against powerful. Let me first respond to what Mr. Mozeroff said, And I think the most important thing is the way he raises awareness of the things we actually don't know. And what we do at the Open State Foundation is trying to get citizens, people, more access to unfiltered information so that people can make more informed choices. Now, we do that by asking and trying and moving governments to open up information they collect and have about us. We are aware that protections and universal rights of people against the powerful, which is the right to information, freedom of expression, and privacy, are unfulfilled, both online and offline. And fulfilling these rights enable people to hold the powerful to account, whether they are governments or big corporations. Now, you can take a pessimistic view and say that those rights and protections will never be fulfilled. But my own experience, both here and elsewhere, has led me to believe that despite all odds, it's worth to strive for. We are aware that we live in a situation where governments try to control access of information, where the entertainment industry harms privacy, and where internet companies carve up the internet in smaller online islands where they make up their own rules. What Mr. Morozov talks about has reminded me of an early debate between the best-selling author Malcolm Gladwell and one of the founders of Twitter, Biz Stone. In 2010, after the Iranian revolutions, he wrote about how revolutions won't be treated. Now, Gladwell argued that the status quo can only be challenged and changed by a top-down military-like organization. Stone argued that big change can also come in small packages. My own experience tells me that when it really comes down to, it's not going to be technology that's going to be the agent of change, but people themselves. So, why I am optimistic? Having lived and worked in the Middle East, I'm familiar with oppression and control. I've lived in situations where your moves are being followed and your freedoms are being hampered. And yes, where also internet, social media, and technology is used both by evil forces and those who try to counter that. I witnessed the change internet technology brought to the way we could connect to family and friends. Being part of a family that has been separated by borders, walls, and regimes, communication technology had been a great instrument. Now, back in 96, for those who can recall, that was the year when Hotmail started. I was living in a city that was closed by the military. Journalists were not allowed to enter. And at the time, I was with a small group of friends, among the few who had access to internet. With servers, of course, outside the country. With international phone lines, so it took ages to upload anything. But we used this technology to inform the outside world about what was happening going on in these towns that were closed off. And without knowing it, at that time we probably produced the first live blogs from a conflict zone, while the term blogs was not even invented then. But if you would ask me whether that access put an end to the closure or the clampdown of the press, not at all. Was it a way to inform outside world what was going on? I bet it did. Did it lead to less violence? I don't know, perhaps. To me, what was talked about before is like the, if you have heard of it, the Milgram experiment of the early 60s. It's a psychologist experiment which tells us about the conflict between obedience to authority and personal conscience. People are surprisingly obedient to destructive but otherwise legitimate authority, be they a government or a big corporation like Google. Some people in some situations, for example, rebellious peers, authority distance, and victim proximity do undermine obedience. So to me, technology could enable access to information and offer means to publish unfiltered information, free from editorial boards and censors. And in that sense, and smartly used, we can undermine obedience, increase authority distance, and make victim proximity even closer, even though obedience will be still strong. So I believe that informed citizens with access to various means of communications and various forms of communication and information can make better judgments than those who don't. In addition, there are more people with experience and knowledge outside powerful companies or governments than there are people who do. The problem is that the powerful know more about us than we do about them. Governments create, collect, share, and buy data to inform decisions. But these data are selections. And as soon as somebody begins to select, he or she will select according to what they feel is important. Now, at Open State Foundation, we try to open up this information. It is data that inform public administrations to make political decisions. We believe that the public has a right to this information in whatever available, reusable, and preferable open form. We believe that there is political, social, and economic value in this data. Open data helps us to verify and sometimes improve information on which the powerful base their decisions. So what's wrong with publishing food inspection data to help inform people about the quality of lunchrooms? Why wouldn't farmers benefit from data produced by NASA satellites? What's wrong in having commuters benefit from public transport data? Why wouldn't we help parents and students to find the right schools and studies for them by reusing education data, which enables parents at the same time to level and hold school administration to account? And how come the government, hospitals, and insurance companies are so secretive about the tariffs of medical treatments? It entails the largest share of public spending. The public at large is obliged to pay taxes and health insurance fees without knowing why there are large differences between prices for the same medical treatment. At the moment, at the Open State Foundation, we are awaiting a court decision on our freedom of information request to the Netherlands Health Authority to gain access to information about the cost of medical treatments. A couple of months ago, a panel of three judges at the district court in Amsterdam heard the case. The central question is whether the public has the right to know. The health authority hides behind privacy arguments, while the health minister assured parliament that privacy was guaranteed to health providers. The conclusion of this case might be very well that a call for transparency brings better protection of privacy. We could already pose the question how many people already have access to this data, and what are they doing with it? And why do they have access as the larger public is left in the dark? We strongly believe that this case both serves transparency and privacy, and that disclosing information about the way health costs are calculated serves public decision making. The road to valuable information for society at large to improve decision making and to influence their own context is full of political, economic, legal, and cultural obstacles. So it's not, as Mr. Morozov said, information is easy to get. It's very hard. More often, data being used to build apps and tools that serve these purposes do not come from government-hosted open data portals. Often, we make special requests for data, and sometimes it takes scrapers to build for that purpose. The data we often need is not the data we have, and at least not what is available on government data portals. The burdens are many, and there are not only technical obstacles, such as legacy and closed systems, but one should not underestimate the cultural forces that obstruct government transparency. These are larger and very political. The most important thing to remember is that the right to information, freedom of expression, and privacy are values that come hand in hand, and that these universal values need to be protected, both online and offline, whether one succeeds or not. 5 years ago, Open State Foundation developed a tool called PolyTwoops. It's a tool to archive deleted tweets from politicians around the world. In August this year, Twitter revoked our ability to use its API, a database that developers can use to build apps such as we did with PolyTwoops. To justify its decision, Twitter explained that all its users are the same and that no one user is more deserving to delete a tweet than another. We did not agree, and we were not alone. We believe that what politicians publicly say is a matter of public record. Even when tweets are deleted, it's part of parliamentary history, and the public should not be kept in the dark on what elected politicians have stated in public, even if they later change their mind. Even the so-called right to be forgotten excludes statements made on the internet by public officials. as well as anything that could be in the public interest. Now, in this case, the citizens' right to freedom of expression, which includes access to information, outweighs the official's right to a retroactive edit. By blocking access to its API, Twitter decided to forsake this universal value, and the only people who benefit are the powerful. So yes, Twitter has its own rules and is free to enforce its own terms. And indeed, it shows how internet companies carve up the internet in relatively small islands with their own rules. However, there are times when what is legal must be outweighed by what is right. Twitter's moves subsequently got backlash from human rights, freedom of expression, and transparency groups that echoed our concerns and insisted that the deleted tweets are still public record. Last week, at its developers conference, the CEO and founder of Twitter, Jack Dorsey, apologized to developers and added that the company has a responsibility to continue to empower organizations that bring more transparency to public dialogue, and mentioned particularly politics. Soon we will find out whether these words are going to be put in practice. Finally, I want to end with one of the great American historians and social activist, Howard Zinn. I recommend everyone to read this book, You Can't Be Neutral on a Moving Train. Someone asked him after a talk, given the depressing news of what is happening in the world, you seem surprisingly optimistic. So what gives you hope? He answered that to him, what was often denounced as romantic idealism, as wishful thinking, is justified if it prompted action to fulfill those wishes, to bring to life those ideals. Now, if you read history in a different way, you will find not only injustice, but also rebellion, not only silence, but also defiance. History is full of instances where people, against enormous odds, have come together to struggle for freedom and justice, and won. Of course, not often enough. And of course, very few, but enough to suggest how much more is possible. And when such occasions happen, we are often surprised, because we have not taken notice of quiet simmering of indignation, of the first sounds of protest. We are surprised because we forget to see that beneath the surface of the present, there is always the human material for change. Thank you.
Respondent I'm going to introduce is Jons Janssens. He's a serial founder and entrepreneur with an MBA in emerging technology from the Vrije Universiteit Amsterdam, the VU University Amsterdam, as they call themselves. Jons states that he loves to start and to build things. He describes his entrepreneurial activity as being a venture architect. He founded Mavia, a platform for automatizing layout processes for printworks. This award-winning startup was acquired by Post.nl. Last year, Jons co-founded the startup studio Disrupted, where they built, as they say themselves, ideas into successful companies.
Well, hello. My name is Jons, as already said. Apart from being an entrepreneur, I'm actually a concerned citizen as well. And that's actually what kicked off my latest venture. I'm actually the founder of Sovereign. We're an honest email provider that doesn't sell your data. And our main goal is actually to put people back in control of their data. Our first step is email, basically. So why would you think email? Email is, when we got thinking, is how can we tackle this problem? There's a lot of talk about privacy, and an evening like this is as well, or a lot of events in Netherlands or in Europe or internationally, basically. There's a lot of talk, but there's not a lot being done. So that's, well, a good case in being an entrepreneur. You can actually do something about it. And we wanted to build an honest alternative to free email. And why is it honest? We call it honest because one of the biggest things is that all the legal statements, those are really not honest if you ask me. So you get people addicted. Mr. Morozov already referred to it. One of the things that I really dislike about the Silicon Valley model is that the free with quotes is not actually free. You pay with your data. And if people would do something like that consciously, then I wouldn't have really a problem with it. But it's not fair for me if you ask someone to read a 60-page privacy statement and then just keep on using the service. So that's why we call our service an alternative or fair alternative to free. And the first step is email. And one of our main goals is actually to make an encrypted email service that my mom can use as well. So I like my mom, but I like children as well. And one of the things is that encryption has been here for a long time, but it's quite difficult to use, actually. And that relates to the honest part as well, is that one side is the legal part, but a very thing that's really not honest, if you ask me, is that children also use these free services, and you can't even discuss that they make a conscious decision of using a service. They could buy candy, or they could use this free service. And that's also a thing we relate to with the word honesty. And another thing I would like to stress, and I do quite a few of these talks as well, and I try to make it as simple as possible. So the analogy Mr. Morozov used with email, with regular mail, we use quite often as well. But another thing is like a phone call as well. You know, if imagine your phone provider would be free, and you were calling with your husband, talking about a new house, and 5 minutes later you would be called back and said, "Hey, I have a nice mortgage for you." Everybody said that would be freaking crazy. But for email, this happens every day. So that's just like the basic problem we're trying to solve. And another analogy that works quite well, actually, and if you look at this, like the theme of tonight as well, if the future and the past, a thing that I see, I see in my generation, is that a thing that is happening to the tobacco industry or the oil industry as well, if you're inside in the eye of the tornado, like 20 or 30 years back, and these industries were being built up, if you're inside the tornado, you really can't see what's going on, probably. And if now, with the knowledge of today, we look back at what was happening with the oil and the tobacco industry with 20, 30 years in hindsight, everybody would agree that's not really a good thing to do. And if you really think about it really simply, blowing smoke through your lungs, you know, everybody, rational, normal thinking people could say, well, that's not going to happen. And that's really a thing. For me, that's happening to the data industry as well. We're inside the eye of the tornado at this moment, and it's hard for people to step back and look 20, 30 years ahead. And especially if you live in a country like the Netherlands, that's basically a country at the size of a city, if you compare it on global scale. And today, actually, I somewhat trust our government here, but what happens to all that data that's out there in either commercial parties or where you don't have any control over? That's my main thing. What's happening if you're living in a country where you cannot trust the government anymore? It's a thing to think about. I actually mostly agree with most things Mr. Morozov said, but one of the things that struck me and that I see in a lot of the debate as well is the negativism in this thing. And I'm glad he relativated his own point of being an internet pessimist. I'm quite a technology optimist in the sense that technology is like, you could compare it like to a sword, you know, it always has two sides, so you can use it for good or bad. But I generally think that if there's one thing in history that really brought progress or well-being to people, it's technology. So if I would place myself in one corner, then it's a technology optimist. And another thing I started thinking was when I was just sitting there is, the only way really to disrupt the current industry like Google or like Facebook or the data industry in general, which has free as its main source of revenue or most popular business model, let's say it like that, is public opinion. And that's one of the things that makes me most optimistic now, is that public opinion is changing, and we see it every day now. It's not on the techie nerdy blogs I read, but it's also in the mainstream media. Now people are getting aware. People are getting are awakening that what's happening to their data, they have to be conscious about it, and they have to make the decisions, and they want to be in control. There needs to be transparency, and needs to be trust. Those are the main things that I see. So I do think there's a way to disrupt the current movement and the current industry. it's public opinion. It's you guys here sitting in this hall. It's people talking to each other and changing the principles and using tech for good, but with different principles. Thank you.
Yevgeny, please join us over here. So we have a political activist, an entrepreneur, and the critic who refuses to be the skeptic. Shall we start with maybe the smallest unit that Yevgeny addressed in the end of his talk, the city, the local. Ariane Alfacet spoke about how he tries to open data for citizens and actually create the necessary awareness that might lead to the data literacy to make an informed political decision. Jons spoke about providing services that put the consumer into control of their own data and their own communication. Yevgeny, do you see a model in those actions? Do you think that is addressing what you proposed at the end of your talk as the model where we could go?
Well, I mean, not really. Again, there is a lot of data that's being produced at the level of the city by various city administrations, governments, various offices, and you know, we can debate how much of it needs to be open, public, and so forth. But I'm much more interested in what's actually happening with the data that we ourselves are generating as citizens and as users of many of those platforms and services. That data in itself, you know, for the most part, it's private because it's generated by us. We can, of course, decide what we want to do with it. We can put it up for sale, we can release it. You can also make the argument, as a lot of startups do and a lot of politicians do, that when we are in the city, we are navigating the public space and some of the data should at least be considered public. I mean, that's a discussion that's to be had. But I'm much more interested in resolving this issue of what happens to the data that we ourselves are generating. And that's not really, as far as I understand, correct me if I'm wrong, but that's not really at the heart of most debates about open data that are happening in Europe and North America, because the data we're talking about in those cases is mostly data that has been gathered by various government agencies. Which, of course, if you're extremely cynical like me, you'll say that, well, NSA already has all of our data anyway, so you can also talk about opening up their data for public benefit, but let's not go that cynical.
Do you want to weigh in, Ian?
Yeah, no, I agree that, but even governments are more interested in data about citizens. So, I mean, if I would enter a municipality, they are anxious to talk to our developers about big data, which in my mind is has almost nothing to do with open data, although open data can be big data, but has more to do with, you know, we want to control. We want to control the city, we want to control the people and control movement or communication or whatever. And I think that the interest, whether by the market or by corporations or by governments, is more about people's data. So, you know, I talked about the right to the freedom of information, the right to privacy, and the freedom of expression, not as standalone rights, but in combination. So, it touches upon privacy, and I think that you know, transparency about I don't actually know where my data is being collected. So, for example, if I do groceries and I don't have a kind of a Kortings card, once I found one and then I use it just to get the discount. I bet the local supermarket knows exactly who's living in that area, knows exactly by their cashier information how many babies are born every month, without having personal data. So that information is out there, is already there. The thing is about control. The thing is about, and I think more, probably this is more boring and philosophical, is the relation between powerful governments, powerful corporations, and citizens, and the less powerful, or the consumers. And I think that how to get some kind of balance between the extremely powerful and the less powerful is by having access to information, protecting your privacy, and allowing your freedom of expression so that, you know, public opinion can be open and whatever.
Well, in the post-Snowden era, we see that that values as privacy and control of information becomes actually a value that becomes a commodification. Jons, you see the market reacting to that, I guess.
Yeah, definitely. I actually usually see, relating to the city as well, I usually see people or things like nodes on a network, you know, that everybody just moving around the physical world is generating data, and he's not really conscious of doing it. And that's why we say that that's the part of the transparency we would like to relate to. Actually, for our own company, we pride ourselves on collecting as less data as possible. That's one of our principles. And I totally not agree that a company could not be a trusted partner in a data play. But he does have to be honest and open and transparent about what his principles are and what his intentions are with that data. If data is used for good, then it's fine. But I do want to know, and if I can trust the party who is controlling my data. And it's not just public data, but a company can be a trustworthy partner, I guess.
But let it hold here for a second. If political decisions say, like I'm a citizen in my role as someone who goes to vote now and then, but I'm also a consumer, and if I purchase information services that allow us to remain in control of our data, then I'm making a political decision for something. But I'm doing that via a purchase, via being a consumer. That can't be the way that our political development is going. So I'm wondering, why isn't this question of being in control of your data, thinking about the monopolies, we have actually quite strong antitrust laws in the countries, why isn't that higher up on the agenda? Yevgeny, what do you think why this is, what is urgent to us or to many, is not part of a political agenda? And I would be also curious to hear from a former politician why this is not part of the daily political agenda.
I think we have to be cautious against reading trends in the technological sector as somehow being outside of the trends we see in the rest of society. You know, my reading of the situation in Europe over the last 3 decades or so would be rather dire, and I think the entire continent has been more or less depoliticized. Questions with regards to the economy and ownership have been systematically disregarded or pushed aside from the center of public debate. Instead, we have focused on issues like law, legality, trust, markets, consumerism, consumer protection, and so forth. The more political issues have disappeared, and it's not just a matter of the technology sector. I think they have partly disappeared. Some of them have been delegated to Brussels, some of them have been delegated elsewhere, some of them have just been dropped from the agenda as a lot of governments in Western Europe and elsewhere have thought that they have finally arrived to some kind of end of history in the early 1990s. With the financial crisis and all sorts of other crises that are now besetting Europe, there is a realization that something is not working. And I think in some sense, you know, Silicon Valley is a nice wake-up call. I'm just not sure who exactly will be waking up. I'm really not sure. Like, it will not. Who are the political forces on the ground in Europe who can currently take on Silicon Valley? I wish I could believe in this great Habermasian idea of public opinion that you have. I just don't see it. I mean, I don't see it with regards to banks. I don't see it with regards to TTIP or TISA. I don't see it in the rest of the economy and the rest of the political life we have in Europe. That said, the only people and the only entities that are currently pushing against Silicon Valley are incumbent monopoly providers and incumbent corporations that are afraid that their businesses will be disrupted. And they mostly happen to be big publishing firms in Germany, banks, automotive industry. You know, this is the people who are afraid that Google and Facebook and others will come and disrupt them. Citizens have lost the vehicles for representation, which has to do with the overall political crisis in Europe. That's why the only debate that currently exists in Europe on issues of Silicon Valley either has this rather, I would say, harmless legalistic dimension. We have to pass more laws, we have to have more checks and balances without questioning who runs or owns those services, who is being pushed by a bunch of corporations who happen to be European and who are afraid that Americans will steal their lunch.
That's the entirety of our debate on these issues. So I do not see what kind of public opinion will enter and move it one way or another. And I'm sorry for being so pessimistic again, but you will see that my pessimism does not derive from my pessimism about technology.
I'm glad that Arjen and Jons are here as well. So Arjen, where is the chance for the civil society?
Well, I mean, I think what Mr. Morozov actually implies is that politics in Europe is failing. That the distance between the public, we the government, of the people and by the people, has been distanced a lot. I mean, if you look at membership of political parties, in the Netherlands, but also elsewhere, is declining. But it also is part of a trend where, you know, when I was young, I mean, we would watch television on one channel the whole evening, where you have a broadcaster explaining which program comes next. This is totally changed. My kids are looking at bits and pieces of a television program, and not on the time that it was broadcasted, but whenever they would like to. And I think that this kind of top-down information from a government to its citizens, or from a school a teacher to his students, is changing. And I think that the communication and information flows between people are becoming more and more horizontal, but the information access is becoming less. So what can people do about it? Well, we try to, with what we do with getting more government information in society for public use, so to get more public information, more public engagement, is something that tries to balance the kind of disconnect between citizens and the public and public institutions.
Yeah, I understand that, but as a former member of parliament, I would like to hear from you, what is your perspective on why isn't our politics, our everyday politics, discussing these agendas? I mean, yes, quite a number of people are interested in this topic, otherwise they wouldn't be here, but why are there so few parties who have data, questions around ownership of data, regulation of data, in their political programs?
Well, what struck me when I was a member of parliament was the knowledge about technology with politicians. I remember a debate about signal intelligence a year before Snowden in the Dutch parliament, where people were looking at me as if I was talking about some kind of conspiracy theory. You can easily and quickly be accused of thinking about conspiracy theories when you're talking about the big scheme, like talking about, you know, Google as a big beast, or about surveillance as an everywhere presence, that you're not taking, you're not being taken seriously in politics. Because of the lack of knowledge, not only in with politicians, but also with civil servants and in public institutions.
I would love to add to that, actually. I'm really critical of politics in general. I think they're ignorant, basically. It's run by old people. And like in my generation, it's all kinds of labels, you know, millennials and digital natives and all that bullshit, mostly marketing terms. But the basic thing, or what even would help, is that every government or every municipality should have a CTO. It's crazy that these powerful institutions, they don't know what's going on. That's the main problem. So exactly what you said, they just don't know what's going on. So imagine like a big corporate organization not having a CTO. Everything is somewhere related through technology, and that's one of the things I usually give as an advice as well. Why don't we have a Ministry of Technology or something like that? You know, that at least they can understand what's going on, because that's one of the main problems I see now, is that they don't get it.
Just a quick question. Is the lack of knowledge on the side of the politicians the entrance ticket for the technology companies to provide services that were earlier provided by the welfare institutions?
Quick answer, yes, but let me add a footnote. And the footnote is that, you know, I'm very hesitant and, let's say, resistant to accept this explanation that it's just a matter of lack of expertise and knowledge.
we have to resist this epistemic explanation of what's happening in Europe. I mean, let's be real. What I have proposed during my intervention, what I have said now, would require a rather drastic stance on quite a few sensitive economic and political issues. We are talking about reversing the process of privatization of basic infrastructure. We are talking about creating a data ownership regime that will not necessarily result in more property rights being assigned to data. We are talking about rather radical political and economic stances, which I think theoretically, politically, and pragmatically make a lot of sense if you want to prevent the kind of hyper-capitalism and hyper-neoliberalism that Silicon Valley has in store for us. The reason why our politicians are not addressing this issue is because they do not have the balls to oppose the underlying political economic processes that currently have created Silicon Valley. The only politicians that have tried, you know, we have a very bad case this year, and that was Syriza party in Greece, and we know what has been done to them. The moment you start questioning basic premises of who owns, runs, and administers what resources, there is a very powerful block that currently exists within Eurozone and Europe that push it back against you. This is not just a knowledge of it's not just expertise, this is not just ignorance. I mean, there are very structural, political, and deep forces here. And this is the reason why these issues are not being addressed. I think we have to see beyond this label of technology, because I'm not talking about technology here. This is what I would like to reiterate. We are talking about the future of work, the future of health, and the future of basic public services. This is what we have to be talking about. This has nothing to do with the internet skepticism, you know, open source, and all of the traditional terms and vocabulary that we use to talk about those matters.
So it is actually not lack of knowledge about technology, but it's more cowardice for the political decisions to take. I would like to open the discussion up to the floor. There are two ladies running around with microphones. If you want to address the panel with a question, please quickly state your name and affiliation and ask a quick question, not a co-referat, please. So, I see a hand over there. Is there a microphone? You can also use the microphone down here, please.
Hello, thank you to the panel for your insight. My name is Luis Fernandez. I'm a hacker and an artist and a teacher. And I have a question for Mr. Morozov. You mentioned that the EU was trying to disrupt companies like Facebook by adhering to the Silicon Valley narrative of the garage entrepreneur, and that this wasn't going to happen. My question is that in this light, what do you make of the EU Court of Justice ruling that revokes the safe harbor policy between the European Union and the US? And could these issues be tackled politically or legally?
Mm-hmm. Should I answer or should we take more questions?
We can take another question. We are indeed in a bit in a rush. Another question? Yes, over there, please.
I have a question for Mr. Morozov. Thanks for the lecture. First of all, I want to say I admire that you stress that we need to go to the root of the problem. But at the same time, I find it a contradiction in what you're trying to say, that you're not looking at the human. So you talk about Silicon Valley, like they're over there, over the sea, you know, while they're actually influencing us. But why don't we look at the human that lives in Silicon Valley, at the man that, you know, why don't we make, you know, an anthropological study of these guys? Because there lies the root of the problem. Do not, you know, look at it sociologically, but look at the if you really want to look at the root of the problem, you have to go to the guys that are in Silicon Valley that maybe don't see a lot of women, maybe masturbate at night, you know. But if you think about that,
combination was Amsterdam here, I can see. Yes.
If you think about that, how much influence that has, that they don't, you know, that they don't have see a woman, you know.
Oh, man. The root of the problem, or
I think women in Silicon Valley can change the world.
Good. Please go ahead.
All right. So on the European Court of Justice, I think again, I welcome the decision. I still think that it points to a rather sad state of affairs where the only institution capable of actually talking a political language in Europe these days is the European Court of Justice. If you looked at the commentary that has been made in light of that decision by the European Commission and by many national governments, they actually are scared of the fact that you actually still have judges who do not toe the line about efficiency, growth, trade, which is the kind of vocabulary that the European Commission today talks. They don't talk about justice or dignity anymore. Those are very outdated terms. The new vocabulary is all about efficiency, trade, effectiveness, money, investments, entrepreneurship. This is the new language of the European Commission, and the judgment that they have made now does not really reflect well on that kind of program. That said, I think we have to be realistic. There will be, and there is, a renegotiation of the Safe Harbor Treaty between Europe and the US. It's currently in the process. My fear is that, given the kinds of developments that are happening in Europe at the national level, if you look at many European countries and governments right now, you'll see that the kind of surveillance laws that they are passing are not that much better than the laws in the US. If you look at the recent French surveillance law, it's horrible. What they do by deploying black boxes and algorithms to predict which people might be criminal or not, it's not any better than what the NSA does. French Constitutional Court has found unconstitutional, as far as we know. Who knows whether it will ever reach the European Court of Justice? Maybe yes, maybe not. So far, situation in Europe is so bad that if American negotiators are smart, which probably they are, they will use it as an advantage in their negotiations to basically claim that Europe is extremely hypocritical. So I don't see how, given the politics of these decisions and given the ongoing negotiations, how Europe can maintain this high stance that has been expressed by ECG, as much as I welcome it. On the question of Silicon Valley and sort of more anthropological study, you know, I did it. I tried to do that with my second book, and I think I was entirely wrong to pursue that kind of analysis. You can go and study and read their talks and speeches and study their lifestyle and basically say that, oh, these people have not read enough poetry. They have to go and read Heidegger or, you know, whoever and live in the Black Forest and understand the intricacy of human condition. The problem is that this is not ultimately what drives these companies. This is not just the fact that, you know, they have this very confused view, or they are somewhat, you know, isolated, and they work in the basement in their garage their whole life, and they're not socialized. This is not the point. I mean, I'm sure, like, this is a way to substitute proper economic and political analysis of what's happening with some kind of humanistic, philosophical, anthropological framework. This will not get you very far. Like, it's nice to invoke it as a way to make fun of those people, and there is plenty of material. I highly recommend you watch Silicon Valley, the new series. It's fantastic, but it doesn't tell you much about how these companies hire lobbyists to then go and influence the kind of decisions that are being made in the European Commission and elsewhere. But you're not convinced them. They're in it to make money. It's like convincing the bankers that they have to work for charity. I mean... Well, I mean, like... No, but they don't have to be interested in it. I mean, but there are structural forces at play here. There are venture capitalists. There are big firms behind it. There are universities. There is the government. I mean, those people are not in it to make the world a better place, despite the rhetoric that they give us. Well, I actually lived in Silicon Valley for 2 years.
I think we've seen that, the negative view. There's another question. We will take that discussion outside in a few minutes, okay? Here's another question, please.
Could I add one thing maybe as well? Is that, I still believe, the solution is not in politics, it's not in lawmaking, it's in you. Like, people have a choice in this themselves as well. Just use something else. It's not, you shouldn't go to Silicon Valley, it's just alternatives. And people have a role in this themselves, and just make a conscious decision of what you want to use and what you won't. There's a really good Dutch saying, not sure if it translates in English, but vote with your freaking wallet, you know? That's the easiest thing to do.
Amber, the microphone in the second row, please. But I think, especially from the point of view of an all-male panel, the question about gender imbalance in technology is absolutely relevant.
Yeah.
So, please, your question.
Hello. My name is Jane. From this series of lectures, we know that we are the origins of the data, but it's debatable whether we are actually the owners of data we generate, because we are not, we are the source, but we are not who is gathering them. We are the tools that where the data come from are not ours. So that being said, all this big data are at this moment being collected by these monopolistic companies that run for profit. But big data means power, and power means
Is there a control. Question coming?
Yeah, I'm developing.
Please come with the question.
I'm sorry. And the modern Western society has never dealt with such a big power. The only example I can think of such a state with such big power is China, where they control the big data, the government. And we don't really know how they use it and how they treat it. And I don't see the Western democratic system very compatible with either harvesting that power and using it as a source, or even knowing how to regulate it and how to gather it, because at this time, only ones who can gather them are the big monopolistic corporations, and the reason they can gather them is because they have the monetary power. How do you make the big distinction right now?
Good. Thank you, Jay.
They only have the power because you use their services.
Come again?
They mainly have the power because you keep using their services. That's basically the premise.
Yeah.
And if there's no alternative, I agree with Mr. Morozov, but if there's an alternative, you are in control. And choose the service or company or, well, government, you can't always choose, but people have a role in this themselves as well. I keep stressing that.
But I also, there are two things I would say. First, I think we have to understand that there are limits to this logic of voting with your feet or voting with your wallet. I mean, you have to understand that there are other processes that are happening. I mean, a lot of the money that you guys pay in Europe in your taxes and eventually goes to the European Commission ends up being given to support the work of giant companies, telcos, telecoms, big technology firms, and it all goes as R&D because they're prohibited from giving legal aid. You cannot just opt out and say, fine, I'm not going to pay taxes, and I'll pay them somewhere else, I'll pay them in Singapore. I mean, this is not an option. I mean, there are big political processes that are happening that are completely invisible. We should resist the temptation to just view it as a market kind of mechanism where we choose what to do and what not to do.
Well, people are not only consumers, they are also citizens with voters' rights. And so if you want to change what the Commission is doing, you can do that by being politically active, getting yourself informed, making sure that politicians are hearing what you say, and at the same time being a very informed consumer. So in that sense, it's not that nothing can be done about it. It's the way we as a community or as citizens and as consumers act.
Well, yes, but again, I would just like to highlight the fact that it's not just a matter of people being ethical or unethical in their choice of platforms. There are many services for which currently you would not find an alternative. There will not be an alternative for a service like Google now. And it's not a matter of you having to internalize this logic and feel responsible for all of the choices that you are making. That would be kind of following the very same neoliberal logic. I mean, we have to be able to imagine that A, there are alternatives, B, we have to imagine that some of the questions here will not be resolved by people choosing or not choosing to participate in a particular platform. Like the question of data ownership here, there is a legal framework that either is in place or is not in place. And then, you know, with the question of big data and democracies, I mean, look at the United States. I mean, I'm sorry, they are sitting on more data than any government in history, probably China. And I actually think Americans probably have the Chinese data while the Chinese don't, despite all the rhetoric of cyber insecurity and cyber hacking.
right? And how are they using it? I mean, like, but you have to understand the model. If Google was not a monopoly, NSA would not have all this data. Google works for the NSA. They're the company that goes and systematically collects all the data like a vacuum cleaner from 25 different domains, puts it in one database, and then all they have to do with NSA, come in and take it. They don't have to take it from 25 sources. They don't have to take it from 25 companies. They can just take it from one. Right? And the question is in surveillance, democracy, monopoly, finance, this is not, you know, rocket science. You can figure it all out. And I'm afraid the situation here is not as rosy. Sorry, we keep talking about consumers' rights and all those fancy things, but like, where is it?
Okay. There are more questions over there. Please.
Do you
speak
agree?
Up.
And I'm looking to the side to explain what it's all about. Here standing, not everybody. Please be aware, people may have objections of posting their face on the internet and making pictures of them without asking their permission. We are reduced to data. And that's what I want to say, how important, as important that is as it is to discuss about the power, about the internet, about the new developments, about all our rights of being aware of what's stored about us. The essence is that we, the people, agree that the new technology has produced a society, an infrastructure, where our behavior is reduced to data.
Is there
I'm not a
coming?
Human being no more, but a data package. And after this, then there's the discussion. And a little bit extra I want to mention. I was very pleased with the book you wrote by saying one of the big problems was, I missed that tonight, one of the big problems is that the internet was kind of mystic thing you had people were believing that was something great in a new society, and it just has to do with
Absolutely, go on.
Money. And
will we take the next question, please?
Okay, my questions are usually also very long, but I'll try to keep it very short. I got a question for Yevgeny and for Jons both together, because I also share this bit negative view. And it's about the solution. So Jons offered the solution of people just using a different service, and Yevgeny offered the solution of really sort of cities trying to escape the reach of Silicon Valley. But how do you see the big obstacle of the fact that what the Silicon Valley companies are offering is particularly the thing that cities or small companies cannot offer, namely the ability to reach everyone? You know, like everybody is on Facebook, and I know that many people want to leave Facebook, but the problem is, like, for example, I'm a blogger and an artist, and if I just leave Facebook, I just lose all of my followers. At least SoundCloud, I lose all of my followers. So cities can only reach people inside a city, and small companies can only, well, reach that many people that are willing to default from this beneficial situation that the big companies offer.
Great, great question. Addressing actually again one of our last points, but also your hope for consumer choice, which seems to be limited quite due to the range of services. Maybe we can make one quick round because drinks are waiting for us outside. Mm-hmm.
So just to clarify, so when I talk about the cities, the reason why I focus on the cities is because I'm just desperate about all other layers that exist in Europe. If we talk about other regions of the world, we can still talk about states having some sovereignty. I mean, we wouldn't name them. But if you look at Europe, I would argue that the only oasis of resistance to the spread of neoliberal ideology in Europe today are cities. And there are not many, but there are some. And that resistance on a city level is much easier to understand and mobilize, because this is where neoliberalism really hits you in the face with privatization of public infrastructure, health, education, everything else. You experience it in a much more direct manner, its consequences and effects, that you would experience it at a national or regional level. This is why I think we do see these efforts at remunicipalization, at opposing privatization of water, as happened in Italy. You know, now all of the rhetoric we're seeing in Barcelona and Madrid, this is happening. This is why I think city is important to keep in the picture, while at the same time presenting fights against Silicon Valley, the internet, big data, however you want to frame it, as the same kind of fights for basic infrastructure and basic right to the city, expressed in very digital, numeric, infrastructural terms, that these campaigns are already fighting in cities. This is why I have positioned the city as the kind of key vector at which this campaign should be started. Clearly, it will not suffice, because you need the nation state and perhaps the regional layer as well in order to pass many of the policies that I would like to pass with regards to control over infrastructure, control over data, and so forth. Cities will not suffice, but it has to start there. And there are all sorts of problems with regards to the opt-in and lock-in that cities currently experience with the rise of smart city proprietary solutions sold to them by HP, Cisco, and all of the big companies. All of that is true, but there is still some money, you know, and there are some cities in Europe which now have very interesting administrations with very interesting commitments to work on very different logics. And if they start pulling money together, things can change. Europe can change if Europe starts putting money into this question, but there is nothing that will come out unless there is an actual commitment on the table to fund particular technologies, particular groups, particular projects.
Jonsson, please.
Yeah, it's a really good point. Actually, it's what I call a monopoly on attention. So marketing in general is just a war for attention. That's basically what it's trying to do. And what these big challenges with what you just described is that a technology like Facebook or any social network, that they tend to come and go. Maybe you still remember something like MySpace. It was really big, it went. And the same thing is going to happen to Facebook, is the thing I'm hoping and predicting, actually. But the main thing is that they're trying to lock you in. And the reason they can lock you in is because of also the network effect. So if you're one person with a Facebook account, you don't have any value. If all your friends have it, then there's value. And that's basically what they're trying to bank on. And that's actually the reason why we chose email. Email is an open protocol. Nobody owns email. It's an open source protocol. It's one of the first things. It's been here for like 30 years. And it's actually that's how we pitch it as well. It's like the biggest social network you never knew you really had. So you can send someone an email in China and they can just open it. And there are, on the positive side, maybe relating to the cities as well, is that the Internet of Things is basically machine-to-machine communication. There's a movement happening now in Amsterdam. It's called the Things Network. And it's actually based on also open source technology called LoRaWAN. And we're part of it, supporting it as well. And it's enabling a machine-to-machine network that's completely open and isn't controlled by a corporation. Okay. So that on a positive note, that's a thing to keep in mind. You know, if you're choosing a service, choose one that's open or even based on open format.
So the message actually of tonight is the change starts with all of you, with everybody who makes a decision for a service or against a service, and a decision in the voting booth during the election. I want to thank our speakers and our keynote speaker, Yevgeny Marozov.
Thank you.
And I'd like to thank you, the audience, who bared with us to the very end, and you'll be rewarded for your patience and your contributions with a drink outside by showing your ticket, your entrance ticket. Thank you all very much.